afternoon, everyone. I, Atiya Khan, welcome you all on the behalf of School of Integrated Social Sciences in today's talk. First, we will all start our ceremony today with the recitation of Holy Quran. Please, Zaim Ahmed, come forward.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أرأيت الذي يكذب بالدين فذلك الذي يدعو اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون الذين هم يراءون الذين هم يراءون ويمنعون الماعون صدق الله العظيم.
Jazakallah. Now I would request you all to please rise on your seats for the national anthem. Thank you, everyone. Now I would request Dr. Rabia Akhtar, Director, School of Integrated Social Sciences, to please come forward.
Assalamu alaikum, everybody. It is a real honor and privilege for all of us at the School of Integrated Social Sciences to have with us Ambassador Robin Raphael. She's an expert in political, security, and economic development issues in South Asia and the Middle East. As a career Foreign Service officer, she has worked for nearly 40 years in foreign affairs agencies, including the U.S. Department of State, U.S. Agency for International Development, and U.S. Department of Defense. She has served as Assistant Secretary of State for South Asia, Ambassador to Tunisia, Vice President of the National Defense University, and Deputy Special Inspector General for Iraq Reconstruction. She managed the sharp increase of development assistance to Pakistan under the late Ambassador Richard Holbrooke, and she was deployed to Iraq with the first civilian contingent after the 2003 invasion to help restore the critical food ration system throughout the country. Earlier in her career, she has served in Pakistan, India, South Africa, and the United Kingdom, and she has taught history at Damavand Women's College in Iran. She is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations and the board of the Association of Diplomatic Studies and Training. Ambassador Raphael holds a BA degree in History and Economics from the University of Washington and Master's degree in Economics from the University of Maryland and Modern European History from Cambridge University. Today, she'll be speaking to us about U.S. policy in the region and beyond. She will also be taking questions from the audience. So as you listen to her, please articulate your questions and we'll get to them. Please welcome Ambassador Raphael to the stage.
Thank you so much, Rabia, for the kind introduction. I'm really delighted to be here with students today. As Rabia mentioned, many, many years ago, I taught at Damavand Women's College in Tehran, Iran, one of my first jobs out of graduate school, and I always had thought that I'd return to teaching at some point. I always find interacting with students refreshing, and it's really good for my aging brain to be able to talk to young people. So I look forward to the Q&A session here. I want to tell you a bit about my long association with South Asia and how the U.S. view of South Asia has evolved over the years. I first traveled to this region in 1971 from Iran, where I was teaching at the time. I went by bus from Herat to Kabul, and a few years later, I drove from Germany to Islamabad, entering Pakistan from Afghanistan over the fabled Khyber Pass. Afghanistan in those days, and I believe there are some Afghan students here, was a very different place from today. Very relaxed. There were a lot of international students and so-called hippies or world travelers, we used to call them, who were passing through Afghanistan on the way to Nepal, which was the center of enlightenment and, of course, a certain amount of drugs and so on. But it was the trail that many students took in that period. And Afghanistan was very tolerant and accepting of these people. So I went on to Pakistan, worked there in the U.S. aid mission for about 3 years, and again, in Pakistan as well, those were much gentler times. I was able to travel all around the country, and, you know, from north to south, east to west, meet people, benefit from the wonderful hospitality of Pakistanis, and see the architecture and the culture and so on, and that has really grounded my affection in this part of the world. Then, 20 years beyond that, I became the first Assistant Secretary of State for a new Bureau of South Asian Affairs in the Department of State. So I want to talk a bit about how South Asia looked to the U.S. in those times. First of all, I would say that this department, this Bureau of South Asian Affairs was established by Congress. And Congress was interested in a different bureau because there were a couple of prominent people, Senator Patrick Moynihan and Representative Steve Solars, who were very keen on India. And they thought that South Asia, being sort of a subset of the Middle East in the State Department, was not giving South Asia the recognition that it deserved. So they forced onto a rather reluctant State Department this new entity. And I was selected to lead this in the first instance. Now, in those days, the South Asia experts in the State Department were just struggling to get South Asia on the map. There were some dedicated experts who knew it well within the State Department. There were scholars and anthropologists and so on who knew South Asia well, but it didn't feature strongly in U.S. foreign policy. It was too far away and relatively quiet at the time. So in the new South Asia Bureau, we touted South Asia's strategic location, the fact that it was home to nearly 25% of the world's population, that it had an English-speaking workforce, vast natural resources, a growing U.S. diaspora. But this was still a hard sell in terms of getting attention for South Asia. At the time, it was the Clinton administration, and President Clinton was very focused not on foreign policy, but rather on the peace dividend from the end of the Cold War and using that in America. That's kind of a familiar theme, I think, in American, for American presidents. They come into office and they want, you know, they say, we're going to fix what's happening in America, and then, of course, events take their own course. That was the case in the mid-90s. Now, for Pakistan, the Russians had left Afghanistan in 1989 after a decade, which seems like a short amount of time relative to the amount of time the Americans spent there. But as you all, I think, know, the Americans quickly lost interest in Pakistan. Pakistan had been our key partner and conduit to the Mujahideen fighting the Russians. But when the Russians were gone, that motive disappeared. And of course, we then invoked the Pressler Amendment against Pakistan for their nuclear activities. We'd held these sanctions in abeyance for the period of the jihad in Afghanistan, but once the Russians were gone, we invoked the sanctions. There were also rising concerns in the U.S. about Pakistan's support for Mujahideen fighters, repurposing them to support separatists in Kashmir. And this, of course, was an early indication of the coming problem with terrorism throughout the region. While at that point, Pakistan still maintained some influence in Congress as a Cold War ally, and there was some enthusiasm over the election of Benazir Bhutto because she was seen as a liberal, modernizing kind of figure. But gradually, Pakistan's fortunes were beginning to wane. Interestingly, however, at that point, Pakistan's longstanding relationship with China was not an issue in the 90s. India. In the 90s, India was beginning to shift away from its traditional non-aligned foreign policy. And it was shifting away from the state control of the commanding heights of the economy, all this in the wake of the collapse of the Soviet Union. But progress there was really slow. The U.S. was encouraging the economic reform, and we could see the potential for U.S. investment and so on. But we were also at that point concerned about India's nuclear program and human rights violations in Kashmir. Interestingly, in the 90s, that was a big issue on our agenda with India. And of course, that was before the Indian and Pakistan nuclear tests in the late 90s. In Afghanistan, the Mujahideen factions were engaged in a civil war. The U.S. embassy there had been closed since 1989 because of the fighting and security issues. And the very robust U.S. cross-border assistance program, where we'd done a lot of work in education and health and so on, was ended in 1993. Again, a casualty of we're going to invest in America less than overseas. So the 3 million Afghan refugees remained in Pakistan, and the U.S. really had very little to do with Afghanistan. Until, of course, the Taliban took over, and then we began to pay attention. And interestingly, the Taliban regime at the time, as everybody knows, was very extreme, very brutal, and this set off alarm bells in Washington, but in large part because of the way the Taliban were treating women, which of course is an echo of what we see today. And interestingly, there was a campaign waged by a very long-standing, well-established women's NGO, I would call it, the National Organization of Women, called NOW, which launched a campaign to let everybody know how the Pakistan were treating women and to make sure that the U.S. government did not recognize the Taliban. And it was very successful, and to this day, the echoes of that early campaign are still heard in the way that we view the Taliban, fairly or unfairly. In many ways, the Taliban regime today is similar to what it was, but in many ways, it's not. But in the American mind, the Taliban are the same as they were in the 90s. So that's the 90s. 5 years later, again, things change dramatically. 9/11 brought Afghanistan back into the spotlight. The Taliban, of course, were driven out of Kabul, and a new government led by Hamid Karzai was set up at an international conference in Bonn. A new constitution was drafted with a lot of international input and was approved in 2004. And I would point out at this point, too, that despite advice from Pakistan and others, the Taliban were not included in this conference at Bonn. And that turned out to be a mistake, in my view, as we found 20 years later. In Pakistan, President Musharraf quickly agreed to support the U.S. effort to destroy al-Qaeda, but again, he advised against going to war with the Taliban. And we ignored that advice, the U.S. ignored that advice, because understandably, after 9/11, we were really angry and we wanted revenge. And so the idea of separating the Taliban from al-Qaeda was dismissed, and we went to full-scale war with the Taliban. But for Pakistan, the sanctions were lifted, military and civilian assistance began to flow again, and dozens of Americans surged into Pakistan to support the war. The U.S., in the early stages, worked very intimately with Pakistan, and there were coalition support funds to support this military effort. There were U.S. special forces working hand in hand with their Pakistani counterparts in Fatah. So it was a very, what I would call, intimate relationship early on. It was later that tensions began to grow over the drone strikes and, you know, who was in charge, whose priorities were more important. But in the beginning, it was quite close. During this period, India took advantage of the opportunity to re-engage with Afghanistan. They'd had a long-standing relationship, but during the first Taliban government, since they'd been associated with the Northern Alliance, they were sort of out of the picture. But when things changed and the U.S. came, the Indians came back in with a major economic development program, and of course they were also taking advantage of the proximity to Pakistan's western border with Balochistan. The U.S. very much welcomed this because, number one, the U.S. wanted all the help and support it could get in Afghanistan, but also felt that India was a regional power that had the ability to do development and to promote democracy in Afghanistan. After the initial desire on the part of the U.S. to keep a light footprint in Afghanistan, of course, the U.S. shifted to a nation-building strategy. And they invested billions of dollars to create a democratic state and a modern army. While there were definitely improvements in development indicators over the years, literacy rates, health indicators, and so on, ultimately, corruption, the lack of a real political consensus among the Afghans, in addition to the growing Taliban resistance, proved an increasing challenge for the U.S. program there. Back in Pakistan, with the return to democracy in 2008 and the election of the PPP government of President Zardari, which coincided with the election of Barack Obama in the U.S., there was a renewed effort to try and fix the Afghanistan project. So we set up this so-called AFPAC structure in the U.S. State Department. It was headed by a very prominent, extremely active, very, very capable diplomat, Richard Holbrooke. So again, there was a renewed surge of U.S. troops and civilians on the Afghan side. But also there was a decision to dramatically increase civilian assistance to Pakistan. And this was a very deliberate effort to demonstrate that the U.S. effectively cared as much about the civilians as they did about the military, which we had been, of course, aiding massively off and on over the years. So it was a huge amount of money in terms of U.S. Aid levels at the time, $1.5 billion a year for 5 years, and it was a five-year commitment that was authorized. It had to be appropriated in our system by the Congress every year, but it was a big deal to have committed that much money over a five-year period. And that's one of the times when I came back to Pakistan to oversee that program, the so-called Kerry Luger Berman aid program. With the increase in staff at the U.S. Embassy, construction began on this huge new embassy, which some of you may have seen in Islamabad. And it was designed to accommodate not only a large civilian staff, but also a contingent of these special forces operators that were working in Fatah at the time. But over time, it did prove difficult to align and keep aligned U.S. and Pakistan approaches towards Afghanistan. The U.S. grew increasingly frustrated with what it saw as the double game. I'm sure any of you who've read about this period are familiar with that term. The U.S. thought that Pakistan was helping us on the one hand with Al-Qaeda and so on and supplying our military in Afghanistan, but at the same time supporting Taliban entities, the Haqqani network and the Quetta Shura, who were resident inside Pakistan. So that was frustrating for us, and at the same time, Pakistanis were frustrated because we started doing our drone targeting independently, and there was always a struggle over these, what we called coalition support funds, which were reimbursements to the Pakistani military for their deployments on the western border and their logistical support in helping us supply our troops in Afghanistan. And these kind of tensions and bad feelings came together in what I would call a perfect storm in 2011 when a U.S. contractor, Raymond Davis, killed two people in broad daylight on the streets of Lahore. And the U.S., of course, in May of that year, had its operation in Abbottabad against Osama bin Laden, and we did that without really telling Pakistani authorities in advance because we wanted it to stay secret and secure, but needless to say, that caused hard feelings. And then finally, there was this incident on the Afghan border at Salalah where, in a kind of fog of war incident, the U.S. accidentally killed 24 Pakistani troops. So in 2011, relations took a bit of a nosedive. Switching back to India during the same period, while tensions were increasing between the U.S. and Pakistan, India's fortunes were steadily rising. Their economic reforms, which I would argue need to happen in this country as well, but that's a separate issue. The economic reforms in India brought about rapid economic growth, a rise in consumerism, modernization of their military, and an awareness of the U.S. of the enormous potential for U.S. trade and particularly U.S. arms sales. And the U.S. in this period also began to see India as a potential counter to the rise of China. And interestingly, during the negotiations for the Indian nuclear deal in 2005-06, when the State Department was trying to sell the Congress on this deal because it had to be approved by the Congress, the main selling point was the counter to China. And that was back in 2005-06. The U.S. was looking at India as a status quo power, a democracy that shared its values and shared its interest in preventing proliferation and terrorism and so on, and again, as a big market for U.S. arms. So a number of new bilateral security agreements were signed with India in that period and later, and we really began to develop this security partnership. And at the same time in Washington, there were well-funded programs in think tanks around Washington, D.C. and beyond in other parts of the country. and they did lots of studies on the potential for U.S.-Indian relations, the Indian economy, defense cooperation, social progress, and so on. And everyone was talking about how do you take the U.S.-India bilateral relationship to the next level. This was at the same time U.S.-Pakistan relations were still struggling from this year of 2011, where these three unfortunate incidents happened. So the Indians began to remain very confident in their relationship with the U.S. and seeing themselves as a long-term partner. But still, there were some tensions that were beginning to surface with India as well. India was beginning to sense that the U.S. expected that it would be sort of a proxy in its conflict with China. And of course, India has been very, very consistent, and it's quite evident today, but very consistent in their foreign policy of strategic autonomy. They didn't really want an alliance with the U.S. They wanted a relationship with the U.S. They could see all the benefits, particularly in the trade and defense sphere, but they didn't want to be committed to a real alliance. And they also didn't wish to be told, you know, who they could be friends with. So at various points, the Indians have reached out to Beijing. You know, even after the border conflicts couple few years ago, the Indians have reached out to the Chinese. From their point of view, again, wanting to keep their options open, wanting to feel autonomous. And at the same time, the trade disputes, which we had hoped to resolve, we thought we could resolve, really kept on simmering. From the U.S. point of view, the Indians were very stubborn in terms of any negotiations. And particularly the whole issue of intellectual property rights and patents and so on was really beginning to disturb even the U.S. business community, who'd been among the greatest supporters of the U.S.-Indian relationship. So things there were, you know, were still on track, but you could begin to see some of the tensions. Now, when Trump came into office, by the end of his first year, released a new South Asia strategy. And he, although he had campaigned on leaving Afghanistan, he agreed to a modest troop increase in Afghanistan. He was under the influence of one of the many generals who thought we should keep fighting in Afghanistan. So he agreed to a modest troop increase. But he also pledged to increase pressure on Pakistan to stop supporting the Taliban and to force the Taliban to come to the peace table. He also called for further enhancing the strategic partnership with India, and that's when we renamed what we used to call the Asia-Pacific and our Asia-Pacific strategy to the Indo-Pacific strategy. Yeah, in large part as a gesture to India. But not surprisingly, Trump soon lost patience with Afghanistan. I mean, he hadn't wanted to stay in the first place. He got talked into it, and then he sort of ran out of patience. So he finally authorized direct talks with the Taliban. And this is when Ambassador Khalilzad started talking to the Taliban in Doha. Now, as many of you might know, we actually had had contacts with the Taliban earlier, starting around 2009. We'd identified an interlocutor and checked him out and so on. But at that point, we weren't willing to be public in any discussion with the Taliban. So we got outed by a German newspaper, and so that was the end of that for the time being. But Trump started again. And of course, after a couple of years of very exasperating negotiations from the U.S. point of view, we finally concluded the Doha agreement with the Taliban, where basically We agreed to withdraw our forces, and the Taliban agreed not to attack us anymore, either U.S. forces or our allies. They agreed to not let any terrorist groups or anybody attack us from inside Afghanistan or any of our allies. And they agreed to negotiate with other Afghans to determine a new political dispensation for Afghanistan. That was the basic deal. It wasn't really conditional. It wasn't very explicit, which is, you know, part of the downside of it all. But it did allow U.S. troops to exit, and that was President Trump's main goal. Many Afghans, of course, were upset with this agreement, primarily because it excluded the Afghan government. And as I suggested, it seemed to give way too much to the Taliban in return for not enough. But President Biden coming into office, who also had thought that we long since should have left Afghanistan, decided after a 4 or 5 month review that he would stick with the Doha agreement and set a date certain for the withdrawal of U.S. troops. And we all know what happened, a very, very disastrous exit and entry into Kabul of the Taliban, which I was very heartbreaking for many people, Afghans, of course, but also those of us who had worked on the Afghanistan issue over the years. Some of my colleagues who were at the airport at that time are still suffering from PTSD because it was a very, very difficult problem. And, you know, many people, 120,000 Afghans in a couple of weeks were evacuated on U.S. aircraft who were coming into Kabul airport one after the other. But the problem was it wasn't a very orderly system, and a lot of people who we had committed to enabling to come to the United States under the special immigrant visa program, because they had been interpreters or translators for the U.S. forces or worked for the U.S. embassy, were left behind. So we're still working on that program of getting these people out and settled in the United States. So that leads us to the present day and how the U.S. is viewing South Asia now. In fact, our core interests really haven't changed that much. No safe haven anywhere in South Asia, Afghanistan, otherwise, for terrorist groups that could attack the U.S. or its allies. And included in that is a strong view that Pakistan needs to better control groups on its own soil, like Lashkar-e-Taiba and so on. That's been a persistent talking point for the U.S. with Pakistan over the years. The U.S. wants nuclear programs in South Asia to be contained. They want weapons not to be vulnerable to be taken over by terrorist groups, non-state actors, or accidentally lost, or anything like that. That remains a concern. And regional stability, and by that they mean no more civil war in Afghanistan, tensions between India and Pakistan under control, India-China rivalries contained, and no more major refugee movements. All of those are key interests for the U.S. On the next level down, of course, economic development, prosperity for the countries in the region, connectivity. Some of the projects that had been planned for connecting Central Asia down to Pakistan through Afghanistan have been put on hold. But from the U.S. point of view, that kind of connectivity in the region is very healthy and therefore in U.S. government interests. And then there are the clear new priorities that have entered in onto the agenda. Climate change, no surprise, with the floods in Pakistan, And events all around the world, fires and drought and hurricanes and so on, there is really an intensified interest in the U.S. and a realization that countries like Pakistan and India and China have great potential in either controlling or exacerbating the whole climate challenge. So that's a new awareness. And of course, pandemics, global health after COVID. Pakistan, by all accounts, did a really good job of dealing with COVID. So there are lessons to be learned there. And there are also lessons in the health field and the field of infectious diseases that I think Pakistani scientists have to share with the whole world. So that's another issue. And then the issue of green energy. That's, of course, part of climate change, but energy policy and moving more quickly to green energy in a country that's as big as Pakistan is a priority for the U.S. In Afghanistan, after dominating U.S. policy in the region for 20 years, Afghanistan's definitely off the front pages, for better or worse. The policy is being managed by an extremely competent fellow, but he is a mid-level guy, and he just doesn't have that much authority. He's very sensible, right-minded, but his level isn't sufficient to really force new focus or changes in the policy. So we're sort of on automatic pilot. Our priorities, of course, in Afghanistan start with counterterrorism. You can see that by the drone attack, which took out Zawahiri, the al-Qaeda leader. So we haven't given up on that, but I think we've concluded that we can deal with that from, quote-unquote, over the horizon with help from our friends in the region. And we're also concerned, as I say, with bringing out the remaining Afghans who are entitled to the special immigrant visa program so that they can come to the United States. And of course, the U.S. continues humanitarian support to Afghanistan, but we have steadfastly refused to return any of the frozen assets. And many people are critical of that because if you don't give the assets back, the central bank assets back to the central bank, the banking system is stymied and it's really hard for the economy to get going again. There's a new effort where we've taken half of the frozen assets, $3.5 billion, and set up a special fund in Switzerland to use these for things like buying new Afghani notes for the banking system and things like that. But it's not the same as returning these assets to the central bank. Some Americans, particularly veterans, have argued strongly that we should support the National Resistance Front. Ahmad Shah Massoud's son in the Panjshir. But I think really at this point, there is absolutely no appetite for that in the White House. So I think, I don't see a change in Afghanistan policy for the time being. With Pakistan, there's opportunity. You know, over the last few years, as the Afghan war was winding down, a lot of think tanks began to study the question of what next for Pakistan? What sort of relationship can we have after the U.S. is no longer dependent on Pakistan to supply its forces in Afghanistan? Now, there were some who argued, especially early on, rather casually, oh, well, you know, once we're out of Afghanistan, Pakistan really doesn't matter anymore. That, to my mind, was not very wise. And fortunately, wiser voices have been arguing that we need to reset the relationship between Pakistan and the United States on the basis of real ground realities and get rid of the emotional baggage that was carried on both sides. Pakistan has grievances with us, feeling used and then neglected over the decades. We had grievances with Pakistan over their support for the Taliban, over their secret nuclear program that they promised us they weren't doing, and so on. But the sense is now building that, no, we really need to get rid of all that old baggage and focus on what we can really do together. And, you know, it remains obvious, and I have to say, I was saying this 25, 30 years ago, Pakistan is an important country. It has a large population, it has natural resources, it has an agricultural base, it has entrepreneurial talent, it is strategically located both in political and economic terms. It has entree into the Muslim world, which of course the United States does not. And it has a very capable military and nuclear weapons. So that's quite a compelling list. So I think people are concluding that as a power with global reach, the United States really needs to pay attention to Pakistan and in its own interest establish a workable, sustainable relationship. And for Pakistan also, the U.S. has always been an anchor relationship, and the U.S. remains, for all the challenges that the U.S. faces, the preeminent global power with the largest economy, the greatest political, economic, and military reach. So it's in Pakistan's interest as well. So people are thinking about what we can do together, and there are obviously many things. Counterterrorism still remains top the list, both because of Afghanistan, but other parts of the region as well. There are many opportunities in this country for U.S. investment. In a sense, it's kind of a green field in many ways, but the challenge is to partner American companies with Pakistani counterparts in a real hands-on way. And we've yet to develop a good system for that, but a lot of smart people are thinking about it. Educational exchanges have always been part of our relationship, and there's huge potential. When I look at this campus and the number of people and so on that are here, and the work that's being done, it's very clear to me that there's potential for much more exchange at the university level. And of course, I mentioned earlier, collaboration on climate and energy and so on. So there's a lot of potential and a lot of thought going on about how to sustain a workable, practical, realistic relationship between the U.S. and Pakistan. India today continues to be a key U.S. partner. And as I mentioned earlier, we changed Asia-Pacific to Indo-Pacific to make the Indians happy. But in a way, the bloom is going a little bit off the rose. And the tensions on trade issues certainly continue, and that's an underlying thing. But what's happened most recently is that India, with its strategic autonomy policy, has become the chief spokesman for the global south in the issue of Russia and Ukraine. And this is difficult for the United States because we've been looking to get all the major powers on the side of condemning Russia for what it's been doing in Ukraine. And India has held off not condoning the Russian invasion, but talking about the need for a multipolar world, the need for negotiations, and so on and so forth. And I have to say they've done that in a very articulate way, which is all the more frustrating on the American side. And it's also true that the U.S. is beginning to get a bit uncomfortable with some of Modi's policies. Crackdown on Muslim minorities, human rights in Kashmir. This is beginning to surface again. So it's sort of modulated the U.S. enthusiasm for India. But since China remains the global competitor for the U.S. and so on, the U.S. is going to continue to work with India, try to strengthen the Quad alliance and so on, even while realizing it's not a panacea. How are we doing on time? Okay, I think I was going to talk a little bit about the U.S. national security strategy, but I think I'll hold off on that. And if people have questions on it, then we can discuss that. I would say that the U.S. Indo-Pacific strategy came out in February before the overall national security policy, which just came out last week, and it was. Launched by the National Security Advisor, Jake Sullivan, and I know at least one person in the office, in the audience, who's actually listened to his speech about the strategy, and it's logical and it's well-crafted, but it has a lot of contradictions because the world is complicated now. So the U.S. is both competing with China and with Russia in its way, but sees these rising global issues like climate and so on, where if we don't cooperate with China, I mean, the game in climate change is China, South Asia, and the U.S. I mean, that's, and if we can't figure out how to cooperate, we can't move forward in those important lines of effort. So there are contradictions in the strategy, but it's important to read for anybody who's interested in U.S. foreign policy. I'll close there.
Thank you so much, Ambassador Raphel, for such a great overview. In such a short time, I know it's really difficult to, you know, talk about this broken relationship. I don't know what's your choice words for Pakistan-U.S. relationship is. Roller coaster, you know, marriage of inconvenience, and you Google it and thousands of searches come up with names that have been given to this relationship over a period of years. But thank you so much for being here and taking time out to enlighten us based on your experiences. We are now going to take several questions, and please do raise your hands, and we are short on time, but we will take maximum questions. So is it okay if we couple of questions together, right? So please introduce yourself. We need a mic as well. So we'll start from here, and we'll take 3-4 questions together, and then we'll give Ambassador the chance to reply. Can we give it to the students first? If you don't mind, I would want the students to ask first, and then our guests as well, please.
Hello. Hello, ma'am. Hi. My name is Azka, and I am a student of international relations. So what I wanted to ask you today was, you talked about the relations between Pakistan and USA and USA and India, but what about the core problems that might arise if tensions between China and USA were to increase? What challenges would South Asia have to face in that time period? And can we expect another Cold War if things were to get bad?
Hello, hope you are doing well. This is Najiba Hakimi. I am from Afghanistan, and I'm here studying international relations. So as an Afghan student, when you were, ma'am, talking about the situation in Afghanistan, that how did your friend face problems when they get out of Afghanistan at that time last year? And I'm really concerned about the women in Afghanistan, about my people in Afghanistan, about the minorities in Afghanistan. And I want you to, like, you said that U.S. were there for nation building. How U.S. made a nation? How they build a nation there? So another question that I would like to ask, that it is about that how do you assess the bilateral relation between U.S. and Afghanistan for the future? Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Najiba. G. Ajmal, please.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ajmal Haizada, and I'm from Afghanistan. also president of Afghan Initiative Society and student at School of Integrated Social Sciences. My question is this, that the Afghan government felt betrayed.
Please
speak in the mic,
please.
Yeah, it's fine now?
Yeah, louder.
The Afghan government felt betrayed when they were neglected from the peace process. Afghan people weren't taken on board in the Qatar's talk, so we are the ones paying the cost. What has changed the U.S. mind after a long war of 20 years to sit and talk with the Taliban? Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take the U.S.-China first and then the group of questions on Afghanistan. You know, the U.S. very much recognizes that countries like Pakistan and actually around the world are worried about U.S.-China tensions. And what I would say, and this is part of this new strategy that I mentioned, national security strategy, is that the U.S. is really working hard to figure out how to manage those tensions so we don't actually end up in a conflict. And so it's a question of figuring out how we enhance deterrence so that China doesn't continue to move, creating these islands and, you know, making the Taiwanese nervous. So it's a management issue. But the other important thing is I think the U.S. has figured out that it's not productive to say to a country like Pakistan or countries in Africa or whatever who have relationships with the Chinese, you have to choose. We're not doing that anymore. And I think that's really smart. I know many of us have advised that for a long time. But, you know, it takes time for the policy to sort of coalesce. So it is, we will continue to compete with China, but we will not ask people to choose. And we recognize another important part of the strategy is that on the big issues, the global issues like climate change and pandemics, we are no longer favoring democracies in the sense that we will talk to anyone who's willing to work together with others in the world and to promote issues like climate change and rule of law, you know. But they can be autocratic now. So I think that's a move in the right direction. Afghanistan, as I mentioned, was a real trauma in many ways for Americans who had worked there over the last 20 years or who had known it historically. It didn't end well, and it didn't end in a way that was a great credit, you know, frankly, to the U.S. I think people are realizing that. But the question of the negotiations, the fact is that, number one, the Afghan government was told step by step of what was going on in these negotiations. They were not in the dark about what was happening. Number two, the reason we negotiated with the Taliban was because we tried it. You know, we tried to do a three-way negotiation many times. We tried to interest the Taliban in that, and they were not interested in doing that. So we really had no choice. And of course, part of the reason the Taliban wanted to talk to the Americans is that the Americans had the money and the guns. You know, let's be honest here. So that was why we talked directly to the Taliban. We had not wanted to do that for a very long time, because the Taliban were odious to us in terms of their policies, but also because, you know, we were fighting the Taliban. But, you know, as Secretary Clinton said along the way, you know, you don't negotiate with your friends. So, you know, that's what drew us into it. But the reason for the timing was that the war was a stalemate. You know, neither the U.S. nor the Afghan army were going to defeat the Taliban. And when we started these negotiations, the Taliban weren't going to defeat us either. The problem was that time went by and the opportunity for an interim government, you know, power sharing and so on slipped away. And at the end of the day, we ended up where we ended up. you know, and with all respect to the Afghan government, they left, and that is why the Taliban were able to come into Kabul. So it was, you know, it was just unfortunate all the way around. We made mistakes. I think, you know, people are owning up to that now. And fundamentally, you talked about nation building. The U.S., any outsider, couldn't create a democratic government in Afghanistan. Afghans had to do that. And that was the mistake, thinking that we could fast forward a process that actually takes a lot of time. The other thing I would say is that I'm very, and many Americans are very sympathetic with both the struggles of people who left Afghanistan and resettling, and there's an amazing amount of local initiatives, towns, communities, helping Afghans resettle in the U.S. But I also take your point, and a lot of people do in America, that we also owe attention to be paid to the people who stayed in Afghanistan. And ultimately, you know, in time, I hope the educated people will, and like you all, will be able to go back to an Afghanistan that's more representative and where you have a voice. That really should be the goal, and many in the U.S. believe that.
My name is Dr. Fawad Bukhari. I'm head of core engineering at the Center of Excellence, Integrated Engineering Center of Excellence here. My question is out of pure curiosity to know actually, without going into the political correctness, the actual core of the American strategy. What I mean by that there are political and diplomatic constructs that the government make, like promote democracy, human rights, peace, war on terror, and climate change, and all that. And these constructs are used, made openly to take certain things in a politically correct manner. I want to actually to know that no government in the world actually can afford these type of compassionate grounds. They actually do on their own national interest, and you use the right word, ground realities. And these words like peace and all that, they are like some beautiful covering that we use. So I want to know, for maybe the government already know when they negotiate that what's the underlying ground realities, but for the prospective leaders here or anyone for the future, what is actually the strategy of United States towards South Asia, without going into these beautiful covers, in terms of the ground realities and the and actual national interests that the people here, the prospective leaders here should know that would be the actual core strategic interest of United States for the long term to come under in different covers. And what is that thing that I'm really curious to know about?
Good afternoon, ma'am. It's an honor for us to be, it's an honor for all of us to have meeting with you today here at the University of Lahore. And we warmly welcome you to the University of Lahore, and thanks Dr. Rabi Akhtar for providing this session. I'm Nakibul Amashwani from Afghanistan, and actually I'll be asking you questions regarding Taliban and peace talks between United States and Taliban. During the 20 years, we had a hope of freedom, equality, and prosperity. And then abruptly, that hope was broken out when the United States and Taliban started negotiations and excluded Afghan delegates. So it realized us that it was not a hope, but a delusion. So do you think that excluding Afghan delegates from peace talk was a settlement between Taliban and the United States? Between Taliban and the United States. Following that unforeseen settlement and the negotiations between Taliban and United States, do you think that there will be a smooth bond between the United States and Afghanistan? And how can the American help Afghan people to fight their humanitarian and economical crisis, which they have been suffering severely after 15th of August, because U.S. does not have any embassy in Afghanistan? Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Robin, for this insightful talk. I'd like to bring your attention to Pakistan-U.S. relationship a little bit. So historically, we've seen, as Dr. Abhay mentioned earlier, we've seen this, like, these terms of saying transactional relationship, patron-client relationship between the Pakistan and the U.S. And unfortunately, even in 2022, as of now, we see that there hasn't been much progress within the dynamics of this relationship. So while the Pakistani government has been seen to quite equivocally state that we're looking to have development partnerships based on, you know, mutual benefit, equal partnerships, we're open to the entire world for development initiatives, and we want to have a direct one-to-one relationship with all our partners, not just be part of one camp or the other. We see the recent national security policy come out from the Biden administration to continue to view Pakistan from a very security-centric lens, or a very India-centric lens, or how they've mentioned Pakistan as being quite a dangerous country in terms of its nuclear policy and nuclear program. I wonder what your thoughts were. I wondered whether this policy was a deliberate alienation of Pakistan. I wondered what the strategic thinking was back in Washington about taking Pakistan-U.S. relationship forward.
Hello. My name is Meher Banu Naqvi, and I'm doing a Bachelor's of Science in Media and Mass Communication. My question was that Pakistan and China have friendly relationships, and also, as you know, that we are working on CPEC projects. So I want to ask that you have already said that U.S. is competitor of Russia and China as well. So is Pakistan friendship a threat to U.S. interest in this region? Can you please answer that?
Okay, I'm going to take the last question first because I'm struggling to remember the others. As I mentioned, the U.S. realizes that it is not useful to say to Pakistan or any other country that they have to choose between China and the U.S. And, you know, 10 years ago even, when CPEC first started, the U.S. was thinking, oh, okay, you know, China is going to invest in infrastructure that Pakistan needs, that the U.S. doesn't have the money or priority for. The U.S. is more interested in things like education and health at the time, those sorts of projects. So we thought at first that it was fine. Then the U.S. changed its mind, began to feel that the Belt and Road Initiative, as many of you would have heard the term, was debt trap diplomacy, and the Chinese were taking advantage and, you know, getting access to resources or building something and then taking title to it. And now there's a third phase. I think the U.S. understands perfectly well that the Chinese Belt and Road, CPEC, is an effort at expanding its international influence over time, and that the U.S. needs to think, okay, you know, what does the U.S. have to offer that makes it an attractive partner as well? So rather than lecturing countries about taking Chinese loans, figuring out, okay, what do these countries need? How can we help them solve whatever problem that they see as a priority? So that's the goal now, you know, to counter China in third countries by actually trying to figure out how the U.S. can use its particular advantages, technology, education, and so on, to help countries solve their problems so they'll have an alternative to China. That's the goal. Okay. Yeah, you know, the point here is about South Asia. South Asia is a huge chunk of real estate. You know, India, Pakistan is big. As I said, Pakistan's big. You know, you got to pay attention to a country that has the size of a population and all the attributes that can be used for good or ill in the world. You know, so I've always argued, and I think, you know, a number of people see it similarly, this is a region of interest to the United States. We are a global power, so we need to figure out how to ensure, or how to help ensure, that countries in this region prosper in such a way and develop in such a way that it's advantageous not only to their populations, but also to U.S. interests. U.S. interests, whether it's stability, whether it's green energy and climate, whether it's, you know, counterterrorism, all of that. So it's a kind of big picture thing. And in a sense, it's a South Asia is too big to ignore, you know, too big to fail, because it has so much potential for good or ill. I mean, if nothing is done on climate in this part of the world, nothing at all the glaciers are going to melt, and, you know, you're going to end up in a sad state of affairs that ultimately will affect us. And then it sounds rather transactional, and in a way it is, but it's also practical. And it's also the way the world works, and it also puts an onus on the larger power, I think, i.e. the United States.
Humanitarian assistance.
The U.S. is still the biggest humanitarian assistance provider to Afghanistan. You know, so that the U.S. is very much committed to, and in policy terms, that's separate from economic development assistance, for better or worse. So the U.S. and it's separate from politics. You know, the U.S. doesn't want to help this current government in any way, shape, or form in Afghanistan, but it does want to help the people. So the international community and the U.S. has provided a lot of support to that, is actually bringing, you know, cash by hand into Afghanistan to pay NGOs to deliver assistance and so on. So that's ongoing. I mean, my own view is that we should also be engaged in development assistance and helping the banking system get back on track so that the Afghan economy and the common person on the street can begin to earn money and transact business as usual, aside from what kind of government they have. But that's, you know, thus far not a broadly accepted view. You know, Pakistan clearly has a role in, you know, stability in this region, and, you know, That's very important. I mean, Pakistan, you know, whether it's Pakistan-India, Pakistan-Afghanistan, where there are tensions, you know, it's very important to the U.S. that Pakistan play its part in keeping all that under control. And, you know, Pakistan has, as I've listed, enormous assets that can be brought to bear in the global sphere that are important, or contributions to make.
So now we'll take the last round of questions. I'll take notes for you.
Okay.
Hello, everyone. This is Asad from School of Integrated Social Sciences, studying IR in the University of Lahore. First of all, welcome you, ma'am. And after that, thanks to all the faculty members to arrange such a precious ceremony for us. My question is that, as you said, ma'am, that Taliban are the same as they were. If it is, then what was the aim and objective of U.S. and its allies in Afghanistan for 20 years intervention? In 2001, the government of Taliban requested to negotiate with the U.S. and its allies. The interventionists renounced it. But in 2020, the U.S. and its allies arranged the Doha Agreement and handed over Afghanistan once again to Taliban. According to the National Security Advisor of Afghanistan, Dr. Hamdullah Muhib, the agreement of Doha was a major cause of overthrowing 20-year democracy of Afghanistan. Kindly do not highlight in response Al-Qaeda and war on terror, because the game of attacking is on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. This is Sarfraz Korejo, all the way from Sindh. I am also the partner of this prestigious university through my Rotary Club. So my very short, two brief questions. Being a sovereign state, every state has a right to think in her own interest. So would you like, in your academic and sagacious way, about the remarks made by Hillary Clinton and Joe Biden, deep state, the concept of deep state, and the Pakistan's nuclear program. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador Raphael, for an excellent talk. I am Sayed Aliza Jafri. I work at the University of Lahore. So I recently read this National Security Strategy. It was released on October 12th. And I find it full of contradictions, and those contradictions will have grievous ramifications on South Asia, because when we talk about a country's national security strategy and not a policy, strategy means that you not only tell the world that what we want to do, you also tell the world how and where we want to do. And one of the striking things, out of the very many striking things that I have found in that policy, was how hard the policy is tilted towards Iran at a time when both the Iran, the U.S. and its partners are trying to renegotiate or rejoin the JCPOA. And now if Iran, because the use of force has been mentioned many a time in that policy, now my contention and my question would be this: if Iran, if the deal does not resurface as planned, and if the U.S. decides to somehow use force, how could that affect the region, especially given the fact that China is also trying to kowtow Iran in recently?
Thank you. My name is Sayed Qasim Shah, and I'm the student of Media and Mass Communication. Ma'am, I have a short question about Cypher. Cypher has created a political chaos in Pakistan. We just want to know the reality of that Cypher. As you being here, we just want to get an insights.
It's a great pleasure to host you at the University of Lahore, and thank you so much for taking this long Q&A answers. My question is this: that at the initial part of your speech, you said that there was a tolerant Afghanistan once a time in 1960s or 1970s, that you have traveled from Iran to Afghanistan and then to Pakistan. For as an Afghan youth right now that I am in this age, there is a narrative that we are hearing that Americans start the war. Americans end the war where they have started. We see that the Americans, our American partners, they've started the war with the Taliban extremism groups, and that they were they had extremist ideas, and they ended that war with extremism. That then now with the current government or the groups that ruling Afghanistan, it is a very unfortunate state of affairs that we are really witnessing. We have seen previously, but we are experiencing that. My grievances to the American partners is this: that what should we do for a tolerant Afghanistan, a peaceful Afghanistan? What should we do as an Afghan youth? And what is your message to Afghan youths in order to build a tolerant and peaceful Afghanistan? Thank you so much.
Afghanistan. You know, the unfortunate thing at the, one of the many unfortunate things in Afghanistan today, and let me just say parenthetically, I know for all of you whose entire life, for the most part, you know, has been in an Afghanistan that was striving with international support to achieve a country that, where everybody had a voice, where everybody had equal rights, and so on and so forth. That was the goal. That was the intention that the U.S. was trying to support. The problem was, as I mentioned earlier, it wasn't something that the U.S. could achieve. Only the Afghans could achieve it. And the outsiders set up a government and put in place and empowered and kept in power a government that wasn't really as representative as it might have been, and really was losing credibility, was corrupt, and so on. So it was, the U.S. failed to do what it set out to do, but the problem was it didn't have the ability to do it in the first place. We tried to fast forward a process of political evolution in Afghanistan that just was going too fast, and we couldn't do it. And one of the many tragedies is it set up expectations among young people for a very different Afghanistan that is probably going to take some more years to actually manifest itself. And you know, that is really sad and tragic, but it is the ground reality. And it wasn't, you know, the government didn't collapse because the U.S. left. The government basically collapsed of its own weight. You know, it was being propped up by international forces, and you know, there were several opportunities to move to an interim situation where you had some Taliban in a coalition in an interim government, where we could have, you know, worked these issues so that you wouldn't have the Taliban in sole control. And the problem with the Taliban in sole control, as you all have seen, is they're inclining towards their most conservative selves. Now, what I think the U.S. and other outsiders should do, and this is not, there's much debate about this in the United States and the international community, I think the United States should be on the ground in Kabul with the liaison office, talking to the Taliban, all the ministers, day in and day out, to try and encourage them to adjust their policies to what the majority of the Taliban leadership actually want. The majority of Taliban ministers want girls to go to school. Why don't they do that? Because they're concerned about cohesion in the movement, and the more the outside criticizes and pressures and lectures, the more the Taliban coalesce around the most conservative ideology. So I think the answer is engagement, but I will tell you, other people think the answer is isolation. I think it's engagement and empowering the people within the Taliban leadership who want a more modern structure. And that, of course, includes the people of your generation who are the children of Mujahideen leaders, Mullah Yaqub, Anas Haqqani, you know. But it's a very traditional culture, as you well know, and they don't have the same voice as their elders, but in time they will. I haven't seen it. I do not, you know. All I can tell you is that there was no U.S. conspiracy to change the government of Pakistan.
There
you go. Iran. The U.S. The U.S. has been a bit on automatic pilot vis-a-vis Iran for a long time. As I mentioned in my talk, I taught in Iran for a couple of years in the 70s. And it's, you know, lovely people, wonderful culture, wonderful history. It's a very appealing place. Unfortunately, we got off on the wrong foot. With the Iranian Revolution and the taking of the hostages in our embassy and so on. And we've really not been able to get off of that. There have been a few opportunities. We haven't been able to manage it. The effort of the JPCOA, the Joint Political Blah Blah Nuclear Agreement with the Iranians, it was a real tragedy that the Trump administration withdrew from that. Because it's like anything else, it's harder to do the second time. And for the moment, I doubt that we'll be able to grapple with it, at least not until after the U.S. midterm elections in November, because politics affect everything.
And lastly, what every Pakistani wants to know, how dangerous a country are we? Because President Biden apparently thinks so. So would you want to comment on that?
You know, I have no idea why that statement was made. Obviously, you know, I was here, and I'm not in the government. But I think part of it is a sort of throwback to the concerns about this region. You know, and as I mentioned, one of our key priority areas is safety of nuclear weapons here, India, wherever, United States, you know, very much so. So, but what I would say is I don't think there was some study that, you know, produced new information that led the president to say that. I really don't think so. And I think the conventional wisdom within the U.S. government is that, you know, we don't like Pakistan having nuclear weapons, but we think there is a relatively high standard of protections, you know, levels of protections of those weapons. So I don't know what caused the president to say that. You know, mind you, it was a political rally, you know, whatever, but I think that the best approach is not to consider it too much.
There you go. Thank you so much, Ambassador Robert. I would like everybody to please welcome to the stage our Honorable Rector for some closing remarks, sir, and a presentation of souvenir to the Ambassador.
Just a short note, because I think I missed a very important talk today. Being myself tied up, you see, in a number of assignments, so very important assignment, you see, in the office. So, but the discussion and the interaction, what I have observed from the participant, it was tremendous. I mean, it was very nice question, I mean, they put forth. We have to ponder that what sort of strategies and what sort of policies we should frame to bring peace in this region. Because there is a turbulence in the system whereby we are looking at a different sort of thing with the change in climate, you see, particularly. This is impacting, I mean, all the regions, all the areas, and the population, in fact, and the ecosystem and the biosphere as a whole is being affected largely. And we have to frame some astounding policies and strategies, I mean, whereby we can safeguard our people, particularly thriving in this region. You see, I mean, looking at and listening your talk and your comments, particularly on different issues related to Iran, Afghanistan, and also Pakistan, I think we have to live in coherence. We have to respect every country, every population, because they have their own rights. And we should allow them to live, I mean, with the great freedom, with their own policy, what they have talked about, I mean, for their amenities, for their livelihoods, for their prosperity. So I think the U.S. and all the other countries, I think they are very amenable, they are very supportive, and we should respect them. And we should culminate all the differences which are arising, which are emanating from all, I think, misconception, I would say. So with these few remarks, I am very grateful to a legendary and very eminent scholar which you have today in this august house. And you know, if you look at her biography, she has excellent achievement, very astounding achievement, you see. A lot of experience, which you should give a big hand. She has been ambassador to Tunisia, and I visited Tunisia twice. It's a very important country, I mean, in the Arab region. She has also a lot of experience in policy formulation and all other aspects related to politics. And particularly, she is expert on Asian region politics, you see. So it's a great credit for us, great pride for us to have you here in this August. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everybody, for being here and for great Q&A. I know there were so many other questions, but another time, definitely. Thank you so much, everybody.